Welcome to Slash Forward, the channel where we provide summarization and commentary of all your favorite popular and obscure horror movies. In this video, we're going to be looking at David Cronenberg's 1979 film, The Brood. Conceived by Cronenberg as he was going through a divorce and subsequent custody battle, it demonstrates that while you may not appreciate all of his movies, you never have to wonder what's on his mind. Let's peer into it now. The movie opens on two dudes in a dark room, engaged in a match of mental judo.
I guess you're just a weak person.
The character we come to know as Dr. Raglan initiates his strategy of total domination.
It probably would have been better for you had you been born a girl.
And things begin to get strange.
I could look you in the eye if I wanted to, Daddy.
We pan out to discover that this exchange is being observed by an audience, as Daddy continues to berate Mike incessantly and misogynistically. Eventually, Mike finds his voice, though, and rips off his gi, revealing that he's covered in lesions. Take that, Daddy! We come to find out that this little presentation is actually a therapy session, and the outcome may have been positive?
The man is a genius.
I guess. The MC of the show sees the spectators off to their bus. Frank, who's here in personal business, goes upstairs to meet his daughter, Candace, and take her home. During bath that evening, he discovers sores on her back. Incensed, he returns to the facility to confront Dr. Raglan, but is left waiting. And Dr. Raglan's admin describes his deteriorating patients in a somewhat dismissive way.
He's starting to get passionate about the whole thing.
During their meeting, we find out that Frank is not only upset about his daughter, but concerned about his wife, Nola, and she's taken up residence at the facility, and Candace just visits on the weekends. Nola's treatment necessitates isolation, but Frank's not on board with this.
No more weekends with Mummy.
The doctor's intent on maintaining control, and the two fail to come to terms. A quick visit to his lawyer reveals there's little Frank can do at the moment. Psychoplasmics is considered a legit therapy, and taking action to medestabilize Nola wouldn't present favorably in a custody hearing. Frank plays along for now, intending to also seek out testimony or evidence that may call Dr. Raglan's methodology into question. Frank picks Candace up from school, introducing us to her teacher, Miss Mayer. And she mentions that she missed Frank at the parent-teacher conference, but we'll save that for later. Frank drops Candace off with Grandma, where they enjoy thumbing through some old photos. The ensuing conversation reveals that Nola's mother doesn't think much of her chances for rehabilitation, and that they have a strained relationship. We now cut to Nola for the first time, amidst a psychoplasmic session. We see the doctor is role-playing in an attempt to get to the bottom of how Candace sustained her injuries.
Mommy, you hurt me. You hit me with your fists, and you scratched me with your nails.
Nola implies that she would never do this, having learned the devastation of this sort of betrayal from her own mother. Picking up on the insinuation, Dr. Raglan changes tone and becomes Grandma, making forceful assertions and trying to drive more info from Nola in a way that would imply Grandma's guilt, even though the doctor has no way of knowing if this is actually true. As Nola gets increasingly agitated, we see a little door that opens to the exterior of Grandma's house getting pounded open in a progressively violent manner. The end result is my personal worst nightmare, as a container of milk crashes to the floor and quickly spreads. Avert your eyes if you're squeamish, because you know the wood is going to absorb that. It takes a bit to get Grandma moving. She's a little sluggish thanks to the tumbler of bourbon she's been sipping on. She finds the kitchen trashed, and then looks up just in time for some little weirdo to pounce, knocking her to the ground. The little shit then thoroughly tenderizes her face. Afterward, Candace walks in and stands there, ambivalently staring at the carnage. Frank gets a call from the police. An officer on patrol saw a broken window at his mother-in-law's house and went to take a look. They found Candace asleep upstairs. The station psychologist comes in to let them know he's pretty sure she witnessed something. Her behavior and memory loss is a common symptom of traumatized children. He recommends trying to help her remember what she saw so the trauma doesn't express itself in some other way. The next morning, Frank picks up his father-in-law from the airport after he flew in for the funeral. They have a fairly mature conversation in front of Candace.
Maybe it's because she really couldn't admit that we were finished.
And then Frank drops in on an assisted living center to meet Jan, who's currently engaged in his afternoon exercises. Damn, your core must be on fire! Jan introduces himself with some crazy talk about a secondary system in the body no one knows about.
The lymphatic system?
Oh, so they do know about it. They're meeting in the interest of the aforementioned pursuit of testimony. Jan is also preparing a lawsuit against Dr. Raglan, and demonstrates the crux of his case in an unnerving way. He confirms there's a group of them who meet and trade notes, and he offers to help in any way he can. Meanwhile, Grandpa shows up at the facility to arrange for Nola to attend her mother's funeral. He becomes indignant when Dr. Raglan doesn't allow it. Barton vows to come back to take her if she's not released. Having confirmed in his session with Nola that her father's a coward, the doctor doesn't seem concerned. Frank is back at school to pick up Candace, and to pick up where he left off with Miss Mayor. He pulls a classic move, demonstrating his vulnerability by confiding his deepest fears. He's concerned that, despite her young age, he's already managed to screw up his kid.
It's not just you.
Oh, so you're confirming she is screwed up. Frank and Teacher are interrupted by Barton. He's hanging around the old dark house, getting himself drunk and depressed. He tells Frank about his plan to go back to the Institute. Since he's intent on going no matter what, Frank goes to give an assist while Miss Mayer babysits. He figures that Barton's too drunk to drive, so he at least needs to find some way to prevent that. While waiting, Barton wanders around the house, doing drunk stuff. He mourns his way upstairs and lies back on the bed. In the midst of his hopeless cry for attention, we find he has an audience. How good for him! We get our first glimpse of the murderous little freak, but are still left to wonder what the hell it is. When Frank arrives and hears a commotion upstairs, he runs to see what's going on. He bursts in to find Barton bloody on the floor, and before he has a chance to process this, he's attacked with home decor. Showing how well those tennis lessons paid off, he deftly sidesteps and gives chase. The thing manages to get the drop on him, but then falls off and expires after a mere shrug. The inept detective admits they missed the child in their initial search of the house, and suggests it must be some abused kid a nearby neighbor's been keeping in the attic. A good try there. While they're investigating further, Nola tries calling home. Miss Mayer answers the phone, and after a little more than a hello, Nola pops off.
You bitch! You're killing my family! You bitch!
Frank, being a general contractor, was naturally invited to attend the autopsy. They note abnormalities to the specimen. Limited vision, no gens, beak-like gums in place of teeth, a yolk sac on its back, and no navel, indicating it wasn't actually born. That's a lot to take in, and given the novelty of these features, the medical examiner seems a bit underwhelmed. Nola's abusive phone conversations immediately transition into a therapy session in which Dr. Ragland again assumes more than he can know by strongly insinuating Frank and Miss Mayer are together, angering Nola. Frank gets home and finds out his budding relationship has been ended before it had a chance to blossom. Looking for a win after a rough night, he then tries to put Candace at ease by assuring her the thing she saw attack Grandma is now dead. The next day, we find Dr. Ragland, disturbed by news of the murders, ordering all the patients out of the main house. This infuriates Mike, the daddy lover from our opening sequence, who goes to connect up with Jan. Frank arrives, having been summoned by Jan, to see what info he can discover. Mike expresses his frustration. He refers to Nola as the queen and implies that they were sent off in her favor. When pushed, Mike has trouble focusing.
You'd be my daddy. He won't do it anymore. And my real daddy won't do it. And that bastard, Dr. Ragland, won't do it anymore.
Hold it together, man.
Dr. Ragland wants to be alone with your wife.
Oh, that's better. The next morning, we see Frank dropping Candace at school. Two kids approach her and lead her off. It's as though they don't want her to see what's next, which is another brutal beating. Why are there always small hammers available? Frank hears the screams but gets there too late. He takes a moment to stare wistfully at the woman he almost dated that one time, while the rest of the class continues to be traumatized. In her next session, Nola says she was dreaming of Candace returning to her. When Dr. Ragland knocks on the Miss Mayer door, we find that Nola is calm and collected, and in no way threatened by mention of this potential usurper. Meanwhile, Frank is heavily engaged in the search for his daughter, while being continuously sandbagged by the detective.
Frank, what are we doing here?
Who can't seem to keep up as Frank leads the way. We see a brief scene showing the Odd Ones are leading Candace through the snow, and no motorists seem to be concerned. Meanwhile, Frank is being visited by Mike, who begs him for food and is paranoid that someone is following him. When Frank presses him, he mentions the disturbed children Nola's been taking care of. With the dots connected, Frank rushes off to the institution. Frank confronts Dr. Ragland as he creeps around one of the cabins. He tells the doctor that the kids killed Miss Mayer and, he suspects, brought Candace back to the Institute. Dr. Ragland looks shaken for the first time, indicating that he's losing control. He says that Candace is one of their troop, and it's not safe to take her away. Frank makes a passing reference to Nola being a surrogate of other children, but Ragland corrects him.
She's not their surrogate mother, Frank. She's their real mother.
And confirms,
more exactly, that the children of her rage.
We find out, similar to Jan's cancer and Mike's lesions, the patients of psychoplasmics suffer from physical representations of psychological trauma. Nola has been birthing babies that respond to her emotions without her knowledge. The plan now is to keep Nola docile and distracted, to keep the brood calm, so Ragland can remove Candace. Frank doesn't trust him fully, but he goes along with it. Frank approaches Nola and attempts to convince her that he wants to be with her for everything.
Look!
Gah! What? Frank is now afforded the privilege of witnessing the most beautiful miracle of nature, a parthenogenetically conceived rage baby emerging from its birth sac. Unfortunately, Nola licking the thing clean is too much for Frank, and he finds himself unable to hide his revulsion. Oh, grow up. Nola sees his deepest emotions reflected in his eyes, robbing him of the ability to lie his way out of this despite his best effort.
You're lying!
This riles up the brood, ending the story for Dr. Ragland. When Nola has the unfortunate thought,
kill Candace before I let you take her!
Frank finds himself with no good solution to an impossible problem, and strangles Nola to silence the brood. It works and he goes to get Candace. As they drive off, we see that Candace is suffering from physical manifestations of her psychological trauma, which I assume implies a happy ending. Good job, everyone! And with that, we conclude The Brood. Cronenberg went on to create a series of well-regarded, now-classic body horror-themed movies. While this one may not rate highly on the list, I think it's one of his better-conceived ideas. It has less studio interference than Scanners and is more approachable than Videodrome. It's just a simple, clean, well-constructed story that gives you a realistic sense of the strife of the characters, and then gut-punches you with an ultimate gross-out at the end. Just a nice, simple, family movie. It's a must-watch. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching.